So, hi, I'm back. So, I'm clearly not Kat. So, normally the next presentation would be given by Kat Bourlangon. So, some of you know her because together with me, she's one of the new board members of EIC, so the European Innovation Council. But before that, she was for 3 or 4 years president of what is called French Tech. And French Tech is a French program where the ambition was to create, I think it was 25 unicorns over 3 or 4 years, and there are 24 now, so that's fairly okay. But she's not here, so she is. She became ill yesterday, and she was going to give a presentation that you'll see now. So I'll give it. They only told me just before entering that finally she would not be able to make it, so it's also for me a bit of a discovery of her presentation, but I'm sure it's going to be quite okay. So there will be no questions and answers, not after and not during the presentation. And all jokes I tell must be laughed with to promote my enthusiasm. Can you put the thing on? How do I click or? Okay, so EIC, so European Innovation Council, what is it? So it's a program that started 3 years ago. This is the third year running, where 10 billion is freed up from European Union to invest in what they call, what is called breakthrough deep tech IDs. So it's a budget freed up so that there's the gap that is currently existing between early stage and scaling companies to be able to fill that up. It's a fairly unique program in a way that it combines research, guidance, grants, and investment. In the past, most of you will know Horizon 2020, which was a lot of grants agreement and sometimes a certain delay. Let's say that European Commission was not always known for being really fast on decision taking. That's quite drastically changed. That's also the reason why we, as a board, it's the first time that an external board has been mandated to manage it. So it's not some high-level committee or wherever. It's a real board actually published. The goal is to be one of the larger deep tech investors in Europe. So the amount that is now currently freed up is 3 billion for direct investment. The goal is that next to the 3 billion, you have a couple of other European instances. There's an additional fund specifically on scaling that was announced 2 weeks ago by EIF, which is a scale-up fund for a bit later stage startups and a bit more tech-only oriented. And then on top of it, the goal is always to do what is named crowding in. And crowding in means that at this stage is really complex for a lot of startups is to quickly go from Series A or pre-seed funding to a next phase. Having EIC or a commission as one of the anchor investments helps a lot because it's secured of already one investor. The goal is each time that approximately 2 or 3 times that amount additionally is crowded in, but it can also be the commission alone. So on some phases, it can be an only investor to it. The goal is, of course, to have an ecosystem. In the previous panel, there was a lot of talk of nobody can do it alone, and it takes, I think José said, 15 years to be a quick success. Well, the ecosystem helps. The two ecosystems next to which are really interesting and good to know is EIT and ERC. EIT is everything related to incubators. So there are 6 incubators, one on energy, one on healthcare, one on digital. There's a couple of them which really help entrepreneurs to scale their ideas. And then the second one is ERC. And ERC is European Research Council. And that's really amazing. I think if I see the number of Nobel Prize winners that are on there, it's quite amazing. It's all the top researchers in Europe that have been regrouped in order so that the research afterwards can become startups. But also what you see more and more is that research becomes part of a startup. And what do I mean with it? It is sometimes a research ID becomes an ID that becomes a company and scale up, and it takes some time. But you also have sometimes startups that start at a certain ID, and there's multiple startups doing the same thing. You could sometimes have research blending in after, and especially in the case of AI, it's possible that AI can be an advantage later on, and that even though it's not an academic or a research ID from the beginning, it becomes one later on. So that's a second area in which the Research Council is working a lot. And we have in the Flemish side, it's an organization called iMinds. It's now merged together and it's called iMEC. We talked about it before, so I was chairman for 5 years of that together with Wim, who ran it. And it's a bit the same principle. So it's there it is, the five Flemish universities who've regrouped 1,000 researchers into an incubator, a fund, an accelerator, and it works both ways. It can be spinning out ideas, but it can also be spinning in technology in a later phase for startups. We had the work program which was approved for this year, which is 1.8 billion at the end, or 1.7 billion. So that's the work program for 22. And we had a board meeting last week in Paris. I think some of the topics will be mentioned here. Three phases that are important. One is TRL is basically the... you could see it as the technology level of the technology readiness level. It's the complexity in terms of technology of any ID or research. So Pathfinder is something that comes really early. So TRL 1 to 4 means fairly basic research. And you have 4 to 6, and you see accelerator is 6 to 9. So that's basically, you could see that as the complexity or the where you are. Pathfinder is always working with consortia. So ideally, you have two or three partners, and ideally from different countries working together. It's still an early research, and the grants are it's mainly grants, and it's up to 3 or 4 million. That's basically the amount that is invested there. In terms of transition, it can already be single entities. It's when you become a bit more mature already, and it goes up to 2.5 million. And then there's individual accelerating ID. So that's the new part for this year. It used to be limited to, I believe, 10 million, and it's now up to 15 million. And we approve now that it can go up to 25 million. So that's as an individual investment, but which is in research-driven IDs. I said here, it's mainly bottom-up. The steering is done by our board. So the board is 20 people from the different countries, and in a perfect gender balance, by the way. And then there's a lot of, we talked about, it's not only capital, but it's mentorship, it's the ecosystem, it's everything related to that. One of the things that they worked a lot on is timing, timing in terms of speed. All kind of grants and subsidies can be really helpful, but if it takes too much time, it takes a lot of the focus of a startup off the product market fit, and that has always been a bit of an issue. In this case, the timing can go really quickly, so the application and the granting goes really quickly because the budget is allocated, and there's a lot of external people now involved in doing that. So this is the board. I'm probably on there somewhere. So we help on the strategy implementation, and it's a combination of researchers, investors, entrepreneurs, as I said, gender balance and geographic balance. So we're 20 nationalities. It's also always great to have. In terms of Pathfinder, a couple of ideas. So Pathfinder is the first stage. So it's really early ideas. You see that there were 860 projects evaluated and 56 chosen on the last call. So that means in terms, what will that be, 6 or 7% in terms of approval rate. So the idea has to be good, but it's a lot of them that are quite amount that is chosen because it's an allocation, because we approved it now for 168, have difficulties with numbers all the time, million that is contributed, and the average grant was 3 million this time. So that's, in terms of grant for research IDs, really good. And you see the number of participants, and this is a constantly open evaluation. Transition is the total allocation here was 99 million. 13 projects were chosen from the calls. There's an element later which calls, because there are 6 calls per year, and they decided on a yearly basis. In terms of EIC Accelerator, there were 5,000 applications that are submitted, so that's quite some competition, because 164 companies at the end are accepted. 96 of those are which is called blended finance, so that means that a combination is given of grants and equity investment. So it's a combination of a subsidy and an investment in your organization or company. There was only 5 that are equity only and 9 that are grant only. So that means basically all of them have this kind of blended finance, and the total funding here was 991 million. You see the ranking of projects submitted and funded. Belgium is, 11th or 12th or so. I see the UK was in that, so we're going to win a spot next year. But France is clearly the winner, Germany. And then you see a couple of other countries. One of the things that is, there's 2 additional elements which are added in terms of criteria. So each time that you have to submit, it goes to the quality of the research, the technology readiness, the implementation. But there's 2 elements that are added. One is a number of female-led or women-oriented projects, which means that it has to be persons either being the founder or C-level of it, and the goal is there to reach 50% of the projects. And a second one is to have a maximum number of what is called widening countries. So widening countries are many of the CEE countries, but there's also widening is also Ukraine. Widening is also a lot of countries, Slovenia, if you look here, Tunisia. There's a lot of countries where there's a lot of innovation are in a different stage, and hence the submittals and the projects are often not as good in terms of quality. And so what we're doing there a lot is to help them in being better and being grant, but also equity ready in terms of projects. That means both on the investor side and on the entrepreneur side, and also on the research side. So if you submit a project, if the startup is initiated by somebody, by a woman, that's an advantage, but also if it involves widening countries. I think it's 2 very strong metrics that have been added. There's a talk this evening, by the way, on the bias that we have still in entrepreneurship. I think it's at the Merode, I don't know exactly, somewhere in the center of Brussels this evening. In terms of accelerator services, you can read. It's quite a lot that took place. A lot of investors, a lot of corporate involved. And I think one of the things to take away here is that they try to involve everybody in that search. So it's when you have a certain ID, one of the goals is that sometimes they said, well, in that phase of your ID, it's best to pull in this corporate or this startup or this researcher. It's as a young or as a starting entrepreneur, age doesn't matter, but as a starting entrepreneur or when you're doing something new, it's sometimes impossible to know whatever happened. Often when I see an entrepreneur said, do you have competition? No, nobody's doing it. Yeah. Usually you look a bit closer and there's 3 doing it, and you look a bit more closer and there's already 9 doing it. But as an individual, it's impossible to screen all that. But from here, there's quite a good view on which corporates are interested in it, which investors are oriented to it. And so one of the elements is, it's called matchmaking or ecosystem making or however you want to call that. But bringing that knowledge really quickly together is something that really helps. One of the things that I also like a lot is, and the previous panel we talked a bit about at US and Silicon Valley and stuff like that. And I stayed there for 3 or 4 years, mainly in LA, but a short time also in Silicon Valley. And what I noticed a lot is, how shall I call it, the funding design that is being done. So at a certain moment when you have great ideas, a lot of investors kind of team up to say, well, there's 20 of those, this is the one, and we're gonna go all in together. And the exit for the end, the end game is having an IPO or some kind of M&A deal. But people time up in a kind of a design of funding. In Europe, it's a bit less the case, which means that often the time to find your next investment takes too much, is too long. I think 15 years ago, the big point was, in Europe, we don't have enough entrepreneurs, or the ideas are not good enough. I think that part has changed now a lot. We don't have any early stage investors, that has changed. We don't have any exits anymore, that has changed. The unicorns, it's less than other regions, but it's there. I think one of the big things that are missing now is fast scaling capital. That's why you now see that most of the high-valued Belgian unicorns, they all have a lead investor being a US fund. And that is because based on US versus Europe, the valuations of companies are a lot lower. So it makes a lot of sense for US funds to invest here in Belgium. And at the end, the first goal should be that it's a successful company. But secondly, it would also be good that we keep some control or some capital in the companies that are successful here, because if the entrepreneurs stay here, the few entrepreneurs that are succeeding that afterwards don't do anything anymore. Afterwards, they all become either investors or mentors or involved in it. And it's just that makes such a great ecosystem. After COVID, I don't think Silicon Valley as a region matters much anymore. Now it's more kind of a mindset. It is these breakthrough innovations that scale rapidly and where people can have this great ambition. And I really believe that we can do that here in Europe as well. These are some of the corporate partners. There's a lot of them you can see, but it's quite a lot of them. The very first, because I accidentally had dinner with him last Friday, it's founder of a French fund called Sofinnova, and they were the one, the first co-investment was a European Innovation Council with Sofinnova on a startup that has pump material design. It doesn't matter, but that was the first one a year and a half ago. In the meantime, bringing up this ecosystem of and corporate partners and larger funds, that's a really interesting element. There's five now. So last week there was an investment in one of the Estonian companies. But these are the five unicorns that come out of EIC. And then you have a lot of them that are worth the 100 million valuation. That's the so-called centaurs. And it keeps on going like that. You see the timeline here at the horizon 2020 at the time. And before that, I think the year 2000 is kind of the first start of the program. And now we're really getting in a faster kind of evolution. These are the three of the main domains of impact. So if you look at the Pathfinder and Accelerator, so those are the ones where the technology complexity is not too deep yet. You see that there's three big areas. On the right is green, everything that is supporting Green Deal, energy transition, and is a key element. And you see here that there's a lot of farm to fork, there's a lot of energy related batteries and storage, of course, autonomous vehicles. You see the number of Accelerator and Pathfinder investments written down here, so there's quite a lot. Then the two others, one is everything that is related to healthcare. We talked about it. There you see a couple of elements, everything that is related to patient care and telemedicine. I think for all of us it's quite clear now that what happened over the last 2 years has also brought an enormous acceleration in everything that is telehealthcare oriented. Most of them, I had a bit the unfortunate effect that 4 years ago my son had a virus which is called mononucleosis. So before we were all working from home, I was already working 2 years from home. That was, do you have Zoom? What is Zoom? Now you can send a link a minute before. But the consequence of it is that we had to do tele education and tele working since 4 years. you cannot believe what a hassle it was to have a virtual meeting with people. Now it's my grandmother has an iPhone with her COVID pass and doing stuff like that. And it means that in terms of acceptance, it's the impact on, for example, education and Medicare and healthcare is enormous. People that are doing rehabilitation based on virtual tracking. If you look here, everything that has to do with healthcare has a huge boost related to it, and that's for the good of it. And then the last one is related to digital and industry in total. There's a lot to do in quantum computing, of course. You see that AI, big data, machine language is one of the leading ones. And we had two great examples here today. And then it has a lot to do on phototonics. Europe is trying to be one of the leader on that. So that gives you a bit of an overview. And for the next years, if I look at the calls, those will remain the key fields of innovation. There's one on which there's still a bit of reflection on structure. That is everything related to, let's call it Web3, because you see there that the US has a bit taken an accelerated approach. If you take the announcement of the last weeks, there were quite some of the, let's call it more renowned US funds that have announced. Andreessen Horowitz does a $600 million investment fund specifically on crypto assets, but also tokens related to it. And then usually it's five domains from NFTs to decentralized finance and some others. But there's we made an overview of it. There is 10 US funds that have now announced a specific fund for Web3-oriented services of over $500 million. In US, we're in Europe, we're still. I haven't seen any big ones. I don't know, José, if you've seen anything. I've seen the largest is 200 million, but nothing compared to. Yeah, and the last one 2 weeks ago was 2.5 billion. And so that's again a domain where we have to be a bit careful on the European side. It's like with all the platforms where at a certain moment Europe was quite the leader. 20 years ago, I remember this cover of, I think it's Fortune or The Economist, I don't know anymore, with the CEOs of Nokia and Ericsson, where they said, who is ever going to beat these guys in terms of mobile communication? It was when everybody had a Nokia or an Ericsson phone and all digital communication was on Skype. So it was 100% European, and now it's nearly zero left. We have to be careful that the Web3, which might be a new form of decentralized internet, and especially also on the infrastructure and the underlying services, that we're not too late on it. So that's why this is an interesting domain to look at. I think that's it. Yeah, here is a bit of. I'll quickly take you through it, but I'll discover part of it together with you. So that's the allocated budget for 2022. So Keith is he's the head of unit, so he basically leads this program. So the this year's budget is 1.7 billion, of which 350. This allocation has to be done in this year. So it's a yearly allocation. So you can see what kind of investment will be done. 350 on Pathfinder. So that's the first four technology TRL levels. Then you have transition is 130 million. And then acceleration is 1.1 billion. The continuity of the main calls, which I indicated. So digital, Green Deal, and everything related to healthcare. With challenges. So challenges are basically when you have a certain call for project being done. So there's two things that you can do to apply to this. Either there's an open application, so you can submit your project and say, well, if my project fits certain criteria, and those are the one. But then there's also every 2 months, there's a specific sector or domain that is published. And then you can apply to it, and it regroups a certain number of projects to it. And the interesting part of it is that when such calls are open, people are invited to come to submit in a virtual way, but also people are positioning themselves to be a partner in the project. So when you do a submission yourself, you have to basically find other partners or other countries yourself. If it's based on a call, there is matchmaking being coordinated around a certain topic. So you can go there and meet other people and say, look, I'm looking for a corporate to have product introduction, or I'm looking for somebody in this country because I want to scale or expand in another element, another country. There's also a lot of, at the end you see EIC prizes, which are, those are often grants related to specific domains or topics. And yesterday there was grants being announced for leading female founders. So that's one that is new. And a second one, which is now being considered, of course, is what can you, what can be done related to tech guidance for everybody who is coming out of Ukraine, because we're coming there with an incredible flow of people who have to find a new way of working and a new life. Basically, technology can be a way to guide them and to give them a future-oriented perspective. It can be people who have been entrepreneurs and you can guide them, but it can also be people, because often it's a fairly agrarian region. They will have difficulties on the language, but programming is just as much a language as a linguistic one. So that could be a way to have an integration of an entire population in Europe. It's a bit early to see where we are, but I saw that in Brussels now, I think there was a 10,000 registration already. So in terms of amount of people that will be arriving, we've never seen that. So we're going to be have to be open in order to find challenges after first help has been given, of course. Yeah, this is an overview of the different applications. You can see that online. There's a, if you type EIC Europe, you can find that. The first application cutoffs are 23 March. If you want to have a full program, you're going to have to hurry up. Then June, yeah, you see the different deadlines. And those are all online, and you see that's the different element related to it. In terms of challenges, there's a lot of, you see carbon dioxide and nitrogen management. So if you look at everything that is Green Deal oriented, energy storage, in terms of healthcare, there's a lot on cardiogenomics. That's a topic where there was quite some breakthrough research over the last years. DNA-based sequencing or data storage. And then in terms, I think there's a lot of investment that have already gone, but that will continue in everything that is alternative quantum computing. But you see the challenges, you can see them online. It's basically every 2 months, another one per type of element. Here you see what has been done over the last years to make it easier for people to succeed. Rebuttal, clearer timeline. So if you disagree or you want to have feedback on that, eligibility of consortia. Sometimes it was not clear who could be part of it. It also often has to do of which company is linked in what way to another one. Elements like that. There has been an acceleration in evaluation criteria, and then a lot to seal of excellence. So these are companies that did not win, but were very close. And that means that for a next time, you get people know already that you have a really quality team and or technology. So this is a kind of an evolution of what has been happened. In terms of technologies that have been that are vital, we talked about it. It's a healthcare, quantum. One of the new ones is space, which also I've seen that there's also in Wallonia, I think, a space fund and being set up. I'm not 100% sure, but that might fit. Also, on the Flemish side, you have some entrepreneurs getting into it. Jurgen Ingels, because we talked about him earlier, is doing some kind of exhibition, but also preparing startups lined up towards that. And then there's, of course, everything related to green, digital, and energy innovation. Investment above 50 million have to be applied for specifically and can be done. So this year is the first year that up to more than 50 million can be invested. And then you have the scale-up initiative, the top 100 potential unicorns. I believe a lot in, if I look at what something that we can learn from French tech. So if you look at the European ecosystem, there's three countries where most of the unicorns came from, UK, Germany, France. In Germany, a lot has been done via applied research. UK has often had a really large market, but what I like a lot about what French tech has done is that they had a combined effort of research grants and investments. And instead of having calls where people could apply to, they had a procedure where they were tracking the best investors or repeat entrepreneurs, or and they were going proactively towards the ones where they said, well, we think that your idea could be ready for this investment or that grant and we'll guide you to get it. So instead of having people applying to public institutions, it was the public institutions reaching out to others and saying, well, we think that your idea or your company or your phase in which you are is perfect for this call and we'll guide you in it. And I think that's what we should do as well. So that we with EIC should do as well. So that's one of the points being discussed. How can we have a proactive element so that based on deal room and pitch book info, which are basically information sites where you can find where a lot of the investors look at to track investments, but it can also be tracked to see, well, who has which investments, where is it taking too much time, where is already good recurring revenue or not, those kind of elements, and then say, well, this investment is perfect for you and we're going to help you getting it. Because at the end, that's how you're going to get the best entrepreneurs in and build a strong ecosystem. There's a lot to do on the gender and diversity index, of course, and there's all the metrics are between 30 and 50%, and it works really well, I think. Also on the board, there's a 50-50 gender balance in our team there, and it's even in terms of nationality, it's 20 different nationalities, and it brings an incredible wealth of perspective. Sometimes we see something from a certain perspective, but other regions have a totally different call. And for example, the way that the Nordics, we have one person is the former head of Startup Norway, and the other person is the chair of the board of European Research Council, and she is Finnish. And the way that they look at applied science and research is completely different. And I really like that. Also how they want to de-risk venture capital. Wim talked about the fact that they now try to de-risk it via insurance companies. It's working for some parts, but it's an interesting idea. At the end, US investor funds also are often pension funds that have been behind the first Silicon Valley ones. And one of the things that have worked a lot is having obliging in terms of purchasing, obliging the public infrastructure to buy from certain startups. Often a contract with a big institution is the same as a venture round. Already talked about this. Yeah, in terms of prices, I mentioned the women innovators ones. There's one on capital of innovation, and there it's mainly to look at what is called the widening countries, and I believe that the prizes are between 50 and 250k per award. There's a lot on procreation, so that's something that a lot of countries ask, because for some startups it's nearly impossible for them to have procurement in large corporates or in public institutions. So that's often one of the scaling potential, especially if you look at healthcare or Green Deal, there's always some kind of public or often some kind of public instance involved. Making sure that startups can get through procurement and have some elements is crucial on that. Not too relevant. This is looking at next year. So the continuity and stability and open calls. So the fact that's an important element, so that you can constantly apply to it and get feedback from that. Every 3 months there will be a cutoff for accelerator. So that means that the challenges now are every 2 to 3 months. The goal is to have there clearly a quarterly approach. Our advice is integrated, and then the last part I think is really important. So I talked about having the ecosystem with EIT and ERC. There's another ecosystem on funding. So you have three big organisms at European level, European Investment Fund, Bank and Council. And there's a working group on seeing how can we really have a huge impact on that. And the third one is a bit a level on having it implemented on a local scale. And local means, in Belgium, local means also, I'm from Limburg, there's probably an association in Limburg as well, but it's somewhat complex. And to do that, but what we have to be careful of is that Europe remains a bit at a, sometimes at a national level only. It doesn't work. You have to get to the regional levels and be sure that it trickles down. Voilà. That's it. 5 minutes. 0 minutes. So that gives... so today I'm Kat and Veronica, I see. But I hope it gives a bit of a view on what EIC does. I've learned to know it a bit more over the last years, but I'm now part of it, and I really think that the way that they operate is close to what an entrepreneur can help. Also, these 20 people on the board now are all some form of entrepreneur, so I can really recommend going there. And if you have any questions, my name is Bart Bex. You'll find my email online, and can send me email. Then if I can help you, it would be with pleasure. All right. Good luck, everyone.